Hi, you're welcome to our physics class. And then the topic of concern today is circular motion. It is actually a very broad aspect of mechanics in physics, but we just want to identify a portion today, and then in our next class we'll try to look at other portion. So circular motion, as the name implies, a circle. Motion around in a circular form, movement of an object in a circular form. Of course, we have some physical entities in our environment today that move in that manner. So we want to look at the movement of an object and what other thing that is of interest there. So because an object is moving in a circular form, it will not be moving on its own. It must have been pushed by something. Something must be responsible for that movement. And what the factor that is responsible for the movement of an object in a circular form is the centripetal force, which is denoted as capital letter F here. Just as linear force is responsible for the movement of an object linearly or translationally, so centripetal force is what is responsible for an object to move in a circular manner. So mathematically, we have it expressed as centripetal force is mv squared over r. We remember from Newton's second law, force is mass times acceleration. So it's actually the product of mass times centripetal acceleration, which is mathematically expressed as v squared over r. We can also look at we also noted something there. We have this v. This v is the tangential velocity, that is velocity of interest, tangential velocity with which the object is moving at every tangent on the supposed circular path of motion. Then we have the angular velocity, denoted as this symbol. That is the rate of change of angular position of a rotating body. So we can express our centripetal force in terms of velocity, that is the linear velocity or tangential velocity, or in terms of the angular velocity. If we express it in terms of linear velocity, we have it as this. If we express it in terms of angular velocity, we have it as this. So we also have that, for because it is a circle, it must have a radius, which is this. So the relationship between the tangential velocity, angular velocity, and radius is denoted as this. So we have V equals omega r. So like I said, it is a very broad topic, but we want to pick it bit by bit. So to see the full understanding of the one we are talking about today, I would like us to examine some example as usual. The first example we are looking at says an object of weight 150 newton. The weight of that object is 150 newton, moves with a speed of 4.5 meters per second. The speed of movement is 4.5 meters per second. Like we should know in mechanics, meter per second shows that it is a linear speed. But if it is angular speed, the unit of angular speed is radian per second. That is angular velocity, the unit is radian per second. So one way or the other in physics or in physical sciences generally, units have a way of identifying variables. So the linear speed is 4.5 meters per second in a circular path of radius 3 meters. They gave us the radius of that circle, 3 meters. And then standardization of units is also of note. The standard unit of weight or force is Newton, that of speed is meter per second, and that of length, radius, is meter. So we're asked to calculate the centripetal acceleration. First, we should look for a centripetal acceleration. Then, secondly, we should look for the magnitude of the centripetal force. We should look for F. All right, from the formulae listed, the equations listed above, we can infer that A equals V squared over R, because we have provisions for V and R. and the units are already standard. So substituting to our value, our V is 4.5 squared, A is, it will be equal to 4.5 squared divided by 3. So the acceleration is 6.75. Don't forget, because it is a centripetal acceleration, it will still be meter per second squared. That's how to calculate the centripetal acceleration. Then secondly, we are asked to calculate the magnitude of the centripetal force. So we know that centripetal force is mass times centripetal acceleration. There will not be need for us to be calculating the acceleration again because we already know the value, but we don't know the mass. So in linear, in mechanics, we know that weight is equal to mass times acceleration due to gravity. So our weight equals mg. So we can calculate our mass from this arrangement. Don't forget, acceleration due to gravity is a constant. We can take it to be 10 meter per second squared for this question. So our mass in this case will be W divided by G, which is 150 divided by 10, which is 15 kg. So we can now say our centripetal force is the mass calculated 15 times centripetal acceleration 6.75 times 15. So the centripetal force on that object will be 101.25 Newton. As you can see, it is very easy if you can dissect and you can apply the formula appropriately. So let's take another example. Let's take our second example. A body moves along a circular path with uniform angular speed of 0.6 rad per second. So our angular speed is 0.6 rad per second at a constant speed of 3 meter per second. So we are now asked to calculate the acceleration of the body towards the center of the circle. What is our acceleration towards the center of the circle? As we know, acceleration can be expressed in terms of angular velocity and linear velocity as V omega. So it's a straightforward solution. We just take it as 3 times 0.6 and our acceleration will be 1.8 meter per second squared. So once we master the formulae, we will know how to apply, and we practice with applying them, it will be easy for us to solve. So for this part of circular motion, let's take the last example. And that one reads, a stone of mass 500 gram. The mass of the stone is 500 gram. Gram is not a standard unit in physics, so we need to change it to the standard unit, which is kilogram, by dividing it by 1000. So it is 0.5 kg. Tied to a rope 50 centimeter long. The length of the rope is 50 centimeter at an angular velocity of, so because the mass is tied to that rope, by the time the rope is being whirled round, the length of the rope would be the radius of the circle formed. So by the time, let's give a pictorial look of what will happen. Let's say this is the mass and it is tied to a particular rope. Let's say this is the person that will apply. By the time it begins to move in a circular form, the length of the rope will form the radius of the circle. So we can assert that the radius of this orbit is 50 centimeter, which is the length of the rope. But centimeter is not a standard unit, so we have to change it to meter, which is 0.5 meter. Then is whirled at an angular velocity of, they gave us the angular velocity, 12 rad per second. Calculate the centripetal force. we should look for F. And then we know centripetal force in terms of mass, angular velocity and radius is F equals m omega squared r. So since we have standardized our units, we can substitute them straight. 0.5 times 12 squared times 0.5. So by the time we multiply everything, 0.5 times 0.5 should be 1 over 4. 12 squared, 144. So we have 36 Newton by the time we multiply everything together. So I hope with these few examples we have taken, we've been able to understand the basis of circular motion, even though I said there is more to it than this. So in our subsequent class, we'll touch the other part. Thank you.